Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chonzong. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Thursday, the 17th of June. India's IT minister slams Twitter for not complying with new rules. Election campaign begins in Pakistan-administered Kashmir. And authorities carry out rescue operations after Nepal floods leave 20 missing. And now for all the details. India's Information and Technology Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad on Thursday lashed out at social media giant Twitter and said it has deliberately defied and failed to comply with new intermediary guidelines. The new IT rules are aimed at regulating content on social media firms, making them more accountable to legal requests for swift removal of posts and sharing details on the originators of messages.
India's Information and Technology Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad on Thursday slammed social media giant Twitter and said it had deliberately defied and failed to comply with the country's new IT rules, which became effective in late May. The new rules, or the intermediary guidelines announced in February, are aimed at regulating content on social media platforms such as Facebook, its WhatsApp Messenger, and Twitter, making them more accountable to legal requests for swift removal of posts and sharing details on the originators of messages. The rules also require big social media companies to set up grievance redressal mechanisms and appoint new executives to coordinate with law enforcement, which Twitter did not comply with.
If others had followed, why can't they follow? We are asking only three officers to be appointed now. We don't think we're asking for the moon, are we? We also said you can pick up anyone of your own employee as an interim arrangement. Therefore, the point is simply is the intention. And once the 3 months period exhausted on the 26th of May.
In the latest, a day after losing its legal protection in India, a case was filed against Twitter over tweets that the police say attempted to incite communal trouble in connection with an alleged assault on an elderly Muslim man on June 5.
As reports of fighting between Afghan security forces and the Taliban continue in at least 80 districts across Afghanistan, the head of the High Council for National Reconciliation, Abdullah Abdullah, said the U.S. troop withdrawal from the country paved the way for the insurgent group to increase the level of violence.
The U.S. troop withdrawal from Afghanistan paved the way for the Taliban to increase the level of violence, said Abdullah Abdullah, the head of the High Council for National Reconciliation, on Wednesday. Speaking at an event in Afghanistan's capital Kabul, Abdullah said that the Taliban is expanding the war and seeks to be the winner on the battlefield, but it will not be able to dominate Afghanistan militarily. He cautioned it is impossible for the Taliban to take over Afghanistan through war. Meanwhile, the UN also called on Afghan warring sides not to lose the current opportunity for peace. Afghan government and Taliban negotiators have met in Qatar's capital Doha over the past 2 weeks to discuss the peace process after a pause when negotiations largely stalled earlier this year. Talks began in September, but the negotiations largely broke off in April when the United States announced it would withdraw its forces by September 11 after a May 1 deadline the Trump administration had agreed with the Taliban. Meanwhile, on Wednesday, European Union's envoy for Afghanistan, Thomas Niklasson, said time was running out for Afghan peace negotiations and more needed to be done to boost the discussions as international forces withdraw from the war-torn nation. Taliban spokesman Suhail Shaheen said on Twitter that on Tuesday, groups from both negotiation teams had met to discuss recalibration of order and sequence of talk sessions. But Niklasson said that to show true progress, substantive proposals needed to be put on the table on each side's plans for the country and outcome of the talks, which the Taliban had not yet provided.
In news from Pakistan, Pakistan's finance minister Shaukat Tareen has said that it is not possible for the country to get out of the IMF, the International Monetary Fund program, at this time when the economy is reviving, ruling out any disagreement. In a testimony before the Senate Standing Committee on Finance on Wednesday, Tareen said he, however, did not agree to the IMF condition of increasing personal income tax to collect additional ₹150 billion that would burden the taxpayers. This comes as talks with the IMF over a sixth review of the $6 billion US loan program has remained inconclusive. The revenue target has been a key topic. Opposition parties have blamed that the budget 2021-22 is laden with tax measures suggested by the IMF, which are anti-poor and will jack up consumer inflation. Moving on, campaigning has kicked off in Pakistan-administered Kashmir for the assembly election in the illegally occupied region, scheduled to take place on July 25 amid the coronavirus pandemic. Locals and activists blame that although Islamabad claims to have given autonomy to the region, the Legislative Assembly is not allowed to pass any legislation without its approval.
Campaigning has kicked off in Pakistan-administered Kashmir for the assembly election in the illegally occupied region, scheduled to take place on July 25 amid the coronavirus pandemic. An election candidate of PTI, the Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf Party, held a public gathering recently and blamed the PMLN, the Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz Party, which has ruled the region for the last 5 years, of widespread corruption and negligence to develop the region. Locals and activists claim that although Legislative Assembly exists in the illegally occupied territory, it is controlled completely by Islamabad and is not allowed to pass any legislation without its approval. Locals have long blamed that over 7 decades of Pakistan's illegal occupation has pushed the territory into the most neglected and backward due to rampant corruption and exploitation by Islamabad. They lament politicians make hollow promises to bring about development every time when there are elections, but all in vain.
In news from Nepal, at least 20 people, including 6 foreigners, went missing after the flash floods in the Himalayan district Sindhupalchok ravaged the central Nepal town since Monday, causing massive damage to life and property. Rescue efforts were underway in flood-affected areas and people were moved to higher grounds. Officials said they suspected the floods to have been caused by a glacial burst.
Nepalese authorities from the Sindhupalchok district of Himalayan nation of Nepal carried out rescue operations on Wednesday after flash floods killed at least 7 people and left at least 20 missing. Local media reports said the missing foreign nationals included 3 from neighboring China and 3 from India. The Nepal government has deployed resources to help assist in rescue and evacuation operations. Several people who have been left displaced expressed they were in a state of shock.
कसरी गर्ने त्यो विकल्प सोध्नै पर्छ हजुर अब के के गर्ने केही छैन अब भएको छ श्री सम्पत्ति ती घरमा छ अब केही छैन अब कसरी के गर्ने कहाँ के गर्ने भन्ने थाहा नै छैन सोच्दै छैन
Several people in flood-affected areas had moved to higher grounds with their belongings, while army helicopters were rescuing those trapped in marooned houses. Hundreds of families had reportedly taken shelter in a local school. Officials said they suspected the flash floods to have been caused by a glacial outburst in a high-lying area bordering Tibet.
A wildlife sanctuary in Pakistan's Sindh province has become a success story in peacock conservation. The Run of Kutch Wildlife Sanctuary recently overcame drought and desertification to make a comeback of peafowl in the arid region through various aggressive conservation efforts.
The Indian blue peafowl, which is found in the wild in Tharparkar region in Pakistan Sindh, had been under severe threat because of long dry spells. It is now making a comeback as conservation staff from the run of Kutch Wildlife Sanctuary is making efforts to provide water all year round and to stop hunters and poachers. Deforestation and drought have led to a loss of habitat and food sources for the flora and fauna of this arid region, forcing many species to die off or to move elsewhere.
जी यहाँ पे हम पानी जो है ना लेके आते हैं अपनी गाड़ियों में टैंकर्स भर के लाते हैं उधर मिट्टी की तरफ से और वो पानी हम यहाँ पे इनको देते हैं इनकी ज़रूरियात पूरी करने के लिए हम कोशिश कर रहे हैं कि इनको अपना नेचुरल हैबिटेट जो है ना वो वापस हो जाए और ये हम इसको अपना सिक्योर कर सकें पी फाउल्स को ये बहुत ही नायाब स्पीशी है दुनिया में कहीं पर भी नहीं है ये यहाँ पर हमारे पास सिर्फ सिंध में है और स्पेशली थरपारकर में है
8 conservation staff has stepped up their efforts by providing more nutritious grains and digging more ponds to retain water.
साल से तो मैंने इधर से आए थे देखा मेरा मिट्टी छह रहने वाला था सारा कारोबार छोड़ के पक्षियों देखा बिल्कुल परेशान देखा उसके पास पानी नहीं थे खाना नहीं थे तो मैंने सारा बच्चों सारों का काम छोड़ के इधर से आया ये पक्षियों को दाना देना बोले ये मंदिर बैद भी मनाए थे
Amid the habitat challenges, the peafowl population hit a low in 2011, officials said, when a viral disease swept through the area, leaving only about 200,000 survivors. Despite the overall drought tendency, officials say the last two monsoons have been wetter than usual, and that has also given some respite.
Following relaxation in lockdown rules, the harvesting of cherry crop is in full swing in Kashmir Valley of India's northern Jammu and Kashmir territory. Kashmiri cherries are always in high demand and enjoy a virtual monopoly as the fruits from the region are preferred across the country and the world for their taste and quality. Cherry growers in Srinagar city of India's northern Jammu and Kashmir territory began plucking process of the fruit on Tuesday as COVID-19 restrictions were relaxed. Cherry is cultivated in many parts of the Kashmir Valley with Shopian and Tangmarg being the major producers. Being an early crop after strawberry, cherry cultivation provides an additional income to the growers. Due to lockdown restrictions, growers and workers were not able to travel and reach the farms to pluck cherries in order to sell it. However, with curbs being released in several districts of Jammu and Kashmir on Sunday, workers were able to travel and carry on with the farm activities.
COVID से हमारा कुछ नुकसान भी हो गया हम यहाँ तक अच्छे से नहीं आ सके तो अब relaxation की वजह से हम यहाँ तक पहुँचे तो जिसकी वजह से हमने ये cherries वगैरह गिलास वगैरह उतार लिए सर
शुक्र अल्लाह का सर इस साल बहुत ही अच्छा फ्रूट मिला है एक्चुअली इस साल तो कोविड की वजह से हमें थोड़ी सी परेशानी हो गई थी उसके कारण जब अभी रिलैक्सेशन हुआ था कोविड की वजह से अभी हमारा फ्रूट निकल रहा है धीरे धीरे हम इस फ्रूट को निकल रहे हैं पैकिंग कर रहे हैं आप देख सकते हैं यहाँ पर पैकिंग हो रही है हमारी फ्रूट की और यहाँ से जाने के बाद हम व्यापारियों को ये माल दे दिए तो आगे मंडी से ट्रांसफ़र कर दें बाहर कंट्रियों में
Kashmiri cherries are always in high demand and enjoy a virtual monopoly as the fruits from the state are preferred across the country and the world for their taste and quality. The horticulture sector is a major contributor to the economy of Jammu and Kashmir. Besides cherries, other fruits such as apples, pears, walnuts and almonds are the major commercial crops of the region.
Well, that's the way it was in South Asia this evening. Before we conclude the top stories once again. India's IT minister slams Twitter for not complying with new rules. Election campaign begins in Pakistan-administered Kashmir. And authorities carry out rescue operations after Nepal floods leave 20 missing. Now viewers can watch the show on SouthAsiaNewsline.com. You can also visit us on Facebook.com/AsiaNewsline and follow us on Twitter @AsiaNewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.